Welcome back, dear students, on our lecture series on transportation engineering. And today is our second lecture on pavement design, in which we are going to talk about the different factors which affects the pavement design, or the different factors we generally consider for pavement design. In our first lecture, we have discussed what is a pavement and what are the different types of pavement. And now in this lecture, which is our second lecture, we are going to discuss that what are the different factors which are going to affect the pavement design, or what are the factors considered in the pavement design. So let's start our discussion on the second lecture. So these are the different factors which one must keep in mind when he is going to design a pavement, and we have broadly categorized these factors into four categories. Number one is traffic and loading. Number two is environmental factors. Number third is material characteristics, and number four is failure criteria. So whenever one designs a pavement, which can be rigid pavement or flexible pavement, he have to consider the traffic loading, number two, environmental factors, number third is the material characteristics, and number four is the failure criteria. So now we are going to discuss all these factors one by one. So let's start number one, which is traffic and loading. So when one design a pavement, what following factors can be considered in the traffic and loading? So there are again four subcategories. One, number one is the axle load. Number two is the repetitions of the axle load. Number third is the contact area. And number four is the vehicle speed. So now let's start with our discussion on axle load only. So what is axle load in traffic and loading? So you can see this simple image. So this is simply called as the single axle with single wheel. This is single axle with dual wheel. This is tandem axle, and this is tridem axle. So this is generally a legal axle load as per IRC. This is 6 ton or 60 kilonewton. This is 100 ton, 10 ton or 100 kilonewton. Likewise, 18 ton and 24 ton. So this is a legal limit which is prescribed by IRC, that one can take this much weight if the axle configuration is something like this. Now if it is confusing, then move to the next slide. So what actually this single axle with single wheel? So if you will see this particular tire, you can see there is a one wheel on the right hand side. So this is the left hand side and this is the right hand side. And same you will see that this is the left hand side and this is the right hand side. So what you will see that this is a single tire on single and single tire. So this is nothing but single axle with single wheel assembly. And the legal limit for this type of the axle means if this part is going to carry some weight, then maximum legally it can take 6 ton only. At the same time, when you look at the rear tire, how much tire you can see the two tires. So just look at this configuration. So this is nothing but, again, it is a single axle with dual wheel. And the legal capacity for this type of the axle is 10 tons. So that simple, you can understand what is the meaning of single axle with single wheel and single axle with dual wheel. Now let's look at the another case. So look at this tire. So again, you can see we are having the tire on the right hand side and wearing tire on the left hand side. So what you will see that this is nothing but a single axle with single tire. So this is a single axle over here, and this is the first tire and this is the second tire. So this, you have one tire on the one wheel on the either side. But if you look at on the if you look take a look of the rear side, then what you will find that there are two axles. So this is a there are two wheels over here and two wheels over here. So this is nothing but a tandem axle, and the legal capacity for tandem axle is 18 tons. So this simply can understand what is the meaning of single axle with single tire or single wheel, and what is the meaning of single axle with dual wheel. And this is an example of tandem axle where you're having two tires means this is tire number one, this is tire number two, this is tire number one and tire number two. So this is the first set of axle and this is the second set of axle. So this is nothing but this is called as the tandem axle. And if you're having three axles together with two wheels, then it is called as the tandem axle, and for the legal capacity is 24 ton. So this is what you can understand. Now in the next case, you can see this is, if you will recall the image, if you will remember the legal axle load for single wheel with dual wheel assembly, it is 10 ton and over here it is 6 ton. So for this type of the vehicle, the total capacity is around 16 ton, which you can see over here. And for the other type of the vehicle, you can calculate from your side, from yourself, that what it would be. Suppose if I'm going to talk about this one, then you know that for the tandem axle, it is 18 ton, and for single axle with single tire, it is 6. So 18 plus 6, it will give you 24 tons. So that you can see over here. And similarly, you can calculate it for 5 axle truck, 4 axle truck, and 4 axle truck with which is articulated, and you can also calculate it for light commercial vehicle, which would be 6 ton on the rear side because you're having single tire, and 6 ton over here. So the total capacity for this light commercial vehicle will be 12 tons. So this simply you can understand what is the meaning of axle load. So this type of the axle you will find generally in India, which are carried by different type of vehicle. And if you are going to see some other images, so you can see this is a tandem axle. This is on the rear side. So this is a tridem axle. On here you can see a tandem axle, and this is a single wheel with single axle. Here you can see articulated kind of the vehicle where you have the single wheel, single axle, then dual wheel, single axle, and tridem axle on the back. Here you can see the tridem axle on the back and the single axle over here, and tandem axle, and single axle over here. Single axle with dual wheel assembly and single axle. So these are the different types of vehicle which are running on the Indian road. And you can see we are having the configuration or say the combination of different type of the axle, which is nothing but single axle, tandem axle, and tridem axle only. So this is nothing but what do we call as a axle load, or simply the axles. Now what you have to consider when you talk about the axles, you have to keep following factors in the mind. The number one, the effect of axle 1, 2, and 3 on the stresses and strain within pavement layer should be considered independently. So whenever you are going to design any pavement, and if you are going to consider this articulated truck, then what you will do, you will consider this axle separately, this axle separately, and this axle separately. Means whatever damage they are going to cause in terms of stress and in terms of strain, you will calculate all these stresses and strain because of the individual axle effect, not because of the whole vehicle. That you have to keep in mind. At the same time, when you're talking about a group of axles, suppose it is a tandem axle. So what you will do in this case, what you will do, this is a tandem axle. So over here, what you will do, each axle cannot be considered independently. So over here, you have to consider this group of axle as a single unit only. You won't be doing that. It is a single axle with dual assembly, single axle with dual assembly. Actually, it is a tandem axle. So what you have to do, you have to consider this as a single axle, which is single means one axle, which is nothing but a tandem kind of the axle. Then when you design a flexible pavement by layer theory, only the wheels on the one side are considered. Means if you are going to design a pavement by flexible pavement method, what you will do, you will consider only either this vehicle or this vehicle. But at the same time, if you are going to design a rigid pavement, then what you will do, you will consider the effect of both of wheels together. So that you have to keep in mind whenever you are going to design any pavement. So this is for flexible pavement and this is for rigid pavement. Now, next slide, what we are going to see over here, that is the repetitions of the axle load. Now, why it is required? So, just understand, the damage caused by each axle depends on its load, configuration, and repetitions that you can see over here. This is a tandem axle load, right? So, the tandem axle, whatever damage it is going to cause, it is going to be different than a single axle truck, right? It is going to be different than the tandem axle truck. So, this tridem axle, whatever it is going to cause in terms of its damage, it is going to be different. Right. So it is possible to evaluate the damage caused by each repetition of axle load group. How we are going to do? Instead of analyzing each axle load group separately, they can be converted into equivalent repetitions of standard axle using equivalent axle load factor. So what we are going to do, instead of what I have shown you in the previous slide, I have shown you different type of the axles. So when we design any pavement, instead of considering all the different axles separately, what we do, we convert all the different type of the axle in a single type only, and that single type is nothing but standard axle. And how we are going to do it? We are going to do it using equivalent axle load factor. So what we are trying to say, that this tridem axle is going to be converted into single axle or standard axle. And how we are going to convert into standard axle? By using the equivalent axle load factor. So let's see how we are going to do it. So what is the standard axle that you must know over here? So standard axle with dual wheel carrying a load of 80 kilonewton. Sorry, a single axle with dual wheel carrying a load of 80 kilonewton or 8 ton or 8170 is defined as the axle load by IRC. So this you can see over here, right? So here what you are having, this is called as the standard axle. So if you are having a dual wheel assembly, there are two tires on the left hand side and two tires on the right hand side, and if they are going to carry total 80 kilonewton load, then this is simply called as the your Excel, standard Excel. Now, what you have to do, you have to convert this 24-ton Excel, which is your Tridem Excel, into a standard Excel. So how you will be doing it? You will be doing it by using the equivalent load factor. So that we are going to see in the next approach. So that is simply called as the ESL's approach. So what is the ESL approach? So you will see over here that equivalent single Excel load is equivalent, is the equivalent repetitions of standard Excel during design life of the payment. So whatever is the design life, suppose the design life is 15 years. So during the 15 years, how many numbers of repetitions are going to come of this standard single Excel load? IRC terms this ESL as a cumulative number of standard Excel during the design life. So as per IRC, this is nothing but the total cumulative number. So this cumulative number is going to be in millions only. So how many repetitions a road is going to have during the design life? It can be 1 million, it can be 2 million, it can be 3 million. And the millions of repetition would be of standard Excel only, which is nothing but your ESL. So what we have written over here, the number of repetitions of different type of Excels are converted into equivalent repetitions of standard Excel by using equivalent Excel load factor. So what we are going to do, the different type of Excel, we are going to convert into equivalent repetitions of standard Excel. How we are going to do it? By using equivalent Excel load factor. And how we calculate it? Using this fourth power rule. So according to MacLeod, equivalent load factor is given by Excel load divided by standard Excel. So suppose you are having a dual wheel assembly, means two tire on this side and two tire on this side, and suppose they are carrying total 100 kilonewton load, right? But you know that this is the Excel load which you are carrying, but you know that the standard load for this kind of the assembly is nothing but it is 80 kilonewton. So what you will do, you will write it over here that 100 divided by 80 raised to 4, whatever you will get equivalent load factor. So it means that the extent of damage, or say the magnitude of the damage of this 100 kilonewton would be how much? It would be something more than this standard Excel. So that you have to understand, which you are going to use, which you are going to find out using ESL approach. That in detail we will be discussing this in the payment design procedure, which is nothing but in terms of your vehicle damage factor. So here you have to understand that this is nothing but your concept of equivalent load factor. So how much damage is going to be caused by this 100 kilonewton with respect to 80 kilonewton, that you can find out using this ELF formula. And here you have to understand that if a pavement structure fails with N1 repetitions of P1 kilonewton load, and similarly N2 number of repetitions of P2 load can also cause the failure of same pavement structure, then your P1 N1 will be equals to P2 N2. So what does that mean? That if if the P1 load is having require N1 repetitions to fail a pavement, then you can say that P2 load will require N2 repetitions to fail the same road again. So if in certain cases, if your load is less, then you may require more repetitions. In certain case, if your load is more, then you may require less number of repetitions to fail that pavement completely. So that you have to understand in the case of ESL approach. After this, we are going to talk about equivalent single wheel load. So that this particular part we will discuss in detail in the another lecture. But as of now, you can simply understand that to carry maximum load within the specified limit and to carry greater load, dual wheel or say the dual tandem assembly is often used. You can see this picture over here. Why we have used the multiple tires? Because we have to carry the more load, or we have to carry the heavy load. So to carry the heavy, right? So to carry the heavy loads, what generally we do? We come up with dual wheel assembly and multiple set of tires. And that multiple set of tires are generally converted into a single type of tire or a single wheel, that is simply called as the equivalent single wheel load, which we will discuss in the next lecture in more detail. So here I am going to skip it. So here you have to understand one more thing, which is nothing but the relationship between the contact pressure and tire pressure. So this is nothing but the inflation pressure or tire pressure. So when your tire pressure is less than this contact pressure, or say which is a case of low pressure, then your tire will be in compression. So in other words, let me tell you that whenever your tire is in low pressure, means it is less than the required inflation pressure, then your contact pressure will be more as compared to tire pressure. At the same time, when your tire pressure is more, or say the tire pressure is high, or say it is more than the inflation pressure, or say the required pressure, that in that time your contact pressure will be less than the tire pressure. So when your case, when you are having the case of high tire pressure, your tire would be in tension, and when you are having the case of low pressure tire, your tire would be in compression. So these things you have to understand, because this contact pressure and tire pressure somewhere affects the pavement design. So that we will see in the next slide. And here there is a relation between the tire pressure and contact pressure. So generally at 7 kg per centimeter square, your tire pressure and contact pressure both are same. But what you will see below this 7 kg per centimeter square, one would be more than another one. So this is a case of low pressure. Over where you can see that your contact pressure, which is the pink one, is more than the tire pressure. And this is the case of high pressure, where your tire pressure is more than the contact pressure. That you can simply see over here. Now, what about the shape of contact area? So generally, when we design a pavement, the true shape of the contact area is elliptical. You can see this image over here. So if you will see this tire, this is nothing but it is a elliptical kind of shape. But for the analysis part, what we do, right, so you will read this in the analysis of the flexural pavement, it is approximated to a circular shape of, for the ease of calculation. Thus, the radius of contact area for a wheel load P and the contact pressure small p can be found out using this formula. So what we are doing for our ease of analysis, we are converting this elliptical part into a circle. And what would be the radius of this circle? The radius of the circle would be nothing but small a. So that we are going to do, we are going to do for our ease of analysis in the case of flexible pavement. But same for the rigid pavement doesn't hold good. And for the rigid pavement, what we do, we convert this whole area into a elliptical plus a rectangle, to semicircle plus rectangle. And what we are going to do, we are going to use this kind of the area for rigid pavement analysis, whereas this is the length of this rectangle and this is the width of this rectangle that you can simply see. And another thing, that is the vehicle speed. So generally, if the speed is more, then what will happen, your large the modulus value would be more and the smaller would be the strain in the pavement. So that simply you can understand that when the vehicle will be moving with the high speed, there would be less magnitude of the strain, and ultimately the extent of the damage would be different as compared to the slower vehicle. At the same time, if you are going to talk about the environmental factor, what you will see that when you are going to talk about the flexible pavement or say asphalt layer, in hot weathers, what you will find that the asphalt layer may lose their stiffness. Why? Because of the hot temperature, the bitumen or the binder will become soft, and because of the softness, what will happen, the stiffness will be reduced. So this you have to keep in mind whenever you are designing a pavement. At the same time, in cold weather, the binder will become stiff, and because of that, what will happen, your vertical compressive strain will be reduced. At the same time, because of the more stiffness of the binder, it may happen that your layers will be cracking. That is nothing but your low temperature cracking that you will see in the, if you will talk about more in the pavement, if you will talk about more pavement design in more detail. Again, if you are going to talk about the rigid pavement, then what will happen, the slab may not be in contact with the subgrade when you are during your daytime. So when you are having the daytime, what will happen, your slab will be deflecting something like this, right? And if this is your subgrade, then what will happen, you will see that from the center it have lost its contact from the subgrade. At the same time, during the night time, what will happen, your slab will be deflecting something like this, right? So during night time, what will happen, if this is your subgrade, then you will see that the edge and corner out of the contact with the subgrade. So these are nothing but the edges, and you can see that they are not in contact with the subgrade. And ultimately what will happen, because of the loss of subgrade contact, the more stresses will be coming because of the wheel load, and that is going to cause more damage. So this is nothing but an environmental factor that you can see over here. Then one more thing, that the difference between the maximum and minimum temperature also causes the joints to open, affecting the load transfer. So that you will see in the case of expansion joint and contraction joint, over where the difference between the minimum and maximum temperature may affect the joint opening, that you will see in the bridges also. Now the moisture variation. So moisture variation in the pavement layer may cause due to either precipitation or high groundwater table. So generally, for proper surface and subsurface drainage measures will reduce the moisture. And for that, sometimes what you do, you keep the water table at least 1 meter below the pavement surface. So that what will happen, because of the capillary action, the water won't come to the pavement layer, and because of that, there won't be any damage, right? So the ill effect of poor drainage include the loss of subgrade stiffness in the flexible pavement and pumping, and loss of subgrade in rigid pavement. So these are the nothing but the, you can say, the ill effect or say the damages which might be caused because of the poor drainage. If anything is going to happen, say the percolation of the moisture or say the water because of the you can say rainfall or because of the capillary water. So ultimately they are going to affect the pavement in terms of subgrade damage or say in terms of loss of support in the rigid pavement. And the second last, which is the material. So in the case of mechanistic method of the pavement design, what we see that for flexible pavement design, the resilient modulus, Poisson ratio of the subgrade and untreated granular layer are important. So if you are going to use a different material, then this value will be different and your design will be different, so that you can simply understand that what is going to happen. At the same time, the dynamic modulus, the temperature sensitivity and the Poisson ratio of the asphaltic layer. So that simply you can understand. If you are going to use a stiff bitumen, then what will happen? It will perform good in the higher temperature, but it won't perform good in the lower temperature. So here you can simply understand that how the materials are going to affect. When you talk about the failure criteria, so this is for flexible pavement, that we are going to talk about the fatigue, rutting and thermal cracking. And for the rigid pavement, we are going to talk about the fatigue cracking, pumping or erosion, faulting, spalling and joint deterioration. So these are nothing but the failure criteria which one can simply take while designing. So if you are going to talk about the rutting only, which is nothing but the, you can say, the undulations which are going to cause because of the you can say soft bituminous layer or say the loose subgrade. And if you are going to talk about this only, then your design might be different. And if you are going to talk about this only, that fatigue cracking, then your design might be different. So ultimately, whatever failure criteria you are keeping in mind, depending on that also, your design may get changed. Suppose if you are going to design a road in Kashmir, so in the Kashmir, the temperature would be generally less and there won't be any rutting because of the higher temperature. So there won't be any consideration of rutting. So if you are going to talk about the Jammu and Kashmir, the design might be as compared to the other city of India, say Chennai or say Rajasthan, where the temperature is much more as compared to the Jammu and Kashmir. So this is a simple example that one can take over here to understand the failure criteria, right? So these are the different factors which we have discussed for the pavement design. Thank you.